What we do here is go back. Hello, hello, and welcome to the March installment of the 2025 Paleo Rewind series. Big shouts to Edge for having me back. It's been a minute since the last time I joined the annual lineup to summarize some of the top stories in paleontology. Actually, it's been a minute since the last time I did a video that wasn't a trailer reaction, so I'll keep the preamble short. Hopefully you've been following this year's run in chronological order so far, but if you haven't, then feel free to hit pause on my video, open another tab, and run back February real quick with Diana on Geoduck Geoscience. Go ahead, do it right now. If you went and did that, welcome back. Now that you're caught up, let's get to the stuff I found interesting in March. We're going to breeze through a lot of this for the sake of time, but links to all the papers and articles will be in the description if you want to dig deeper. Starting off with the new creatures of the month, a study by Federico Agnolin and colleagues described a new late Cretaceous ecosystem in Patagonia's Anacleto Formation, which included the naming of a new titanosaur species, Chatotitan calvoi, based on several partial skeletons. Despite the memes, which the authors clearly knew were coming, the name of this relatively small 7-meter sauropod comes from the indigenous Mapudungan word for salt, in reference to a vast nearby salt flat. Two new Middle Jurassic Ornithischians were described from rocks in Scotland and Morocco this month. Both are pretty fragmentary, so neither author team could justify naming them, but the Scottish one described by Elsa Panciroli et al. Represents Scotland's first partial dinosaur skeleton, while the Moroccan partial femur from Susanna Maidment et al. Is now the oldest known sauropod, the family that contains ornithopods like hadrosaurs and the bony or horn-headed marginocephalians like Pachycephalosaurus and Triceratops. Khalid Mahmoud and colleagues described three pieces of otter jaws from Miocene to Pliocene-aged rocks in Pakistan, each belonging to a new species. The new one they described is between 5.5 to 7 million years old, and was named Cyveonyx bathynathus. They also describe a tooth from Anhydriodon, the lion-sized otter genus, which would probably be a household name right now if the suits at Apple TV weren't afraid of people actually learning things from their documentaries. Probably the biggest headline grabber of the month was the two-fingered Mongolian therizinosaur from the late Cretaceous Bayanshiri Formation, described by Yoshitsugo Kobayashi & Co., which they named Duonychus tsogbatari. Aside from making therizinosaurs the fourth example of theropods going double digits, a particularly cool part about the fossil is that one of the left-hand fingers preserves a nearly complete keratinous sheath, showing just how long these branch hooks were in life. Leaving the realm of vertebrates, the next newly named creature comes from South African rocks that date to the late Ordovician some 445-ish million years ago. Sarah Gabbett and colleagues described two fossils of this animal, which they named Curbos susannae, and identified it as part of the euarthropod group. Interestingly, the fossils at this site, called the Sum Shale, are preserved in such a way that the three-dimensional structure of the internal anatomy is readily visible, and sometimes better preserved than the hard exoskeleton, so the authors were able to go fairly in-depth in describing these sea creatures' squishier parts, like the muscles and tendons. Moving forward to another arthropod discovery, Chong Wu and colleagues described and named a new species of late Cretaceous wasp from the, let's say, controversial amber mines of Myanmar, though the authors state that these fossils were purchased in 2015, during a relative lull in the ongoing catching conflict that has posed an ethical problem for paleontologists. Unfortunately, like many of the creatures found in these amber fossils, the wasp itself is very interesting. Named Sirenobethylus charybdis, all 16 individuals display a strange multi-part grasping structure at the end of their abdomens around their ovipositor that was triggered by sensitive hairs, similar to a Venus flytrap. Not only does this tell us that these wasps were all female, but the authors suspect that this abdominal apparatus was used to grasp other insects and allow the wasp to lay her eggs on or inside of the unwitting host, similar to how many coenobiont wasps operate today, though without the freaky anatomy. Staying in Southeast Asia, a new pterosaur was named from Upper Cretaceous rocks in Thailand. Discovered exactly 2 years prior by a research team led by Sita Manatgun, Gyrodapterus buffetati is the first pterosaur named from the region and is represented by a partial upper jaw and a few pieces of teeth. These pieces were similar enough to better-known pterosaurs for this species to be identified as a type of nathosaurine, a unique group of flamingo-esque filter feeders that were around during the late Jurassic and early Cretaceous. We'll round out the roster back where we started in Patagonia, with the naming of Tucansuchus salamancensis, a new Notosuchian described by Gonzalo Gabriel Bravo and co. Hailing from the Salamanca formation, this 5-meter-long terrestrial croc cousin is notable for the time period it comes from, just 2 to 3 million years after the infamous bolide strike that wiped out most land animals larger than a cat. Since large Notosuchians are known from both before and after the impact event, it wasn't known if the small ones survived and then re-evolved large body sizes, or if the big ones just kept pushing through. This discovery, so temporally close to the extinction event, suggests the second option. Notosuchians were doing something right that allowed them to persist as large land animals where most other species failed. Moving on from new taxa, the next few studies focused more on comparative anatomy. Because these kinds of studies require a bit more in-depth explanation, I'm going to skip over some of them, but again, please check out the description if you want to read further. Most of these papers are publicly available to read in full. If you can't access one, shoot me an email and I can help you out. This first one is fairly straightforward based on the title. Until about 15 years ago, coloration was something we never thought we'd actually be able to know about fossil animals. But the discovery of pigment-bearing cells called melanosomes across a growing number of well enough preserved dinosaur feathers and scales has changed that. This study, led by Ruoshuang Li, took this approach to mammals, sampling the fossilized fur of 6 different Mesozoic mammalia forms from China for traces of melanosomes, and comparing them to those found in living mammals. They found a near-uniform abundance of eumelanin, which creates monochromatic shades of dark brown and gray, or black. The author team suggests that this consistent coloration across an ecologically diverse range of mammals, from burrowers to tree-dwelling gliders, is a sign that mammals started off as fairly dull-colored animals and didn't diversify their pelt palettes until after the extinction of large, keen-eyed dinosaurian predators, though this will require more fossils to bear that out. Another study of some paleoartistic note revealed evidence of a new and unexpected cheek-like soft tissue structure in dinosaurs. This was found by creating and examining thin sections of bone in parts of the jaw where muscles and tendons would attach, specifically the jugal and the rearward bones of the mandible. By comparing these regions to those of living archosaurs, the researchers were able to determine what those attachment points look like on a microscopic level, and were then able to reconstruct what this muscle structure would look like in different dinosaur groups. I mentioned earlier that this was of some paleoartistic note. As artist and lead author Henry Sharp noted online as everyone was freaking out about this, this doesn't really change too much for most dinosaurs unless you're specifically depicting their muscles. The only groups that might have had a significantly noticeable difference are the ceratopsids and tyrannosaurs, smoothing out the cheek region a bit to give it a less horn-like appearance. Going deeper into vertebrate anatomy, we had 2 studies revealing evidence of arboreality in 2 separate branches of the synapsid family tree. The first was a description by Stephen Chester and colleagues of a newly discovered and fairly complete skeleton from New Mexico of a Myxodectes pungens, an evolutionarily early relative of primates and colugos from about 62 million years ago. The paper breaks down every part of its skeleton from head to toe and describes how these features would make for a good climber and long-term tree dweller. The second paper, led by Saskia Nieki, looked at a much earlier mammal relative called Suminia getmanovi. A basal and early member of the anomodonts, which are more famously known for the Permian and Triassic disanodonts, Suminia inhabited the forests of Russia some 260-ish million years ago, and has been suspected to be arboreal since at least the 2010s, based on the anatomy of its limbs and likely prehensile tail. This newest study took the analysis even deeper, comparing the limb proportions and thin sections from several limb bones to compare to living tree-dwelling mammals. The bones all showed similarly low ratios of bone wall thickness, an adaptation that lightens the skeleton and thus makes it easier for the animals to climb. The final animal-focused study we'll talk about in this category concerns everyone's favorite giant extinct fish, Otodus megalodon. Now, for reasons I don't have time to explain here, I don't particularly like megalodon. And this is a very long paper that covers a lot of things and has one of the longest author lists I've ever seen for a paleontological study, so I admittedly skimmed a lot of this. But here are the big takeaways from Kenshu Shimada and colleagues. Firstly, this study supports the idea that Megalodon was a proportionately long-bodied shark, which fits with the hydrodynamic needs of being a large ocean predator. With new proportions calculated from teeth, vertebrae, and other related sharks, they estimate that it could have reached over 24 meters, or nearly 80 feet long, and at that size would have weighed about 94 tons, with a cruising speed in the range of 2 to 3.5 kilometers per hour. Secondly, based on these calculations, this size would put newborn megalodons in the 3.5 to 4 meter range, so about the size of a large oceanic white-tipped shark. Based on this, they suggest that babies may not have used coastal nurseries as much or for as long as previously suggested, which may have put them into more direct competition with white sharks once they appeared, and that might have played a role in their ultimate extinction. Moving on to creatures and topics I actually like talking about, I have to take a minute to mention some Triassic studies real quick. We've got evidence by Mauricio Garcia and colleagues showing healed craniofacial injuries in over 40% of the hererosaurid skulls they sampled. Granted, that's a sample size of only 7, but even then, the fact that nearly half of them are injured in similar ways suggests that this type of face-biting behavior happened pretty frequently and goes back to the earliest stages of dinosaur evolution. Adam Fitch and colleagues described two new poposaurid femora from North Carolina, which expands the known range of these bipedal dinosaur-like croc cousins into the current-day East Coast and the Triassic-aged Atlantic Rift region. Lorgonopsians also got a bit of a range expansion, with a southern African team led by Zanildo Makungo describing a new partial skull from northern Mozambique, which they identified as belonging to the large saber-toothed predator Enostrancivia africana, which had formerly only been known from South African rocks. I know this is a Permian, not Triassic animal, but it's close enough and I like Gorgonopsians. Plus, I happened to meet Zanildo at a meeting last month, so shout out to a new acquaintance. Moving back into and through the Triassic, the last two studies in this section analyze the changes in habitats and ecosystems over the course of the period. Ragon, Charlene, and colleagues created simulations of the global climate based on the Pangean plant fossil record in order to understand how habitats shifted before, during, and immediately after the Permian-Triassic extinction event, aka the Great Dying, the largest mass extinction event in Earth's history. The models show a general warming trend in the 700,000 years following the extinction event, with average global temperatures increasing by 10 degrees Celsius thanks to the intense volcanic activity. The warming climate expanded deserts in the center of Pangaea, while temperate and tropical forests replaced shrubland and tundra-like environments at higher latitudes. A study led by Yudal Mujal picks up the story, specifically focusing on the shifting paleoenvironments and ecosystems of the Central European Basin across the whole Triassic period. There's a good amount of detail in here about the temporal and environmental distribution of different tetrapod groups and their habitat preferences that I don't have time to explain in full, even as a summary, but feel free to pause on one of the best graphical abstracts I've ever seen to take it all in. Certainly a handy guide for anyone interested in the Triassic history of Central Europe. Not every paleontological news story came out in the form of a published peer-reviewed paper, though. The genetic engineering, probably going to end up as a designer pets company, Colossal Biosciences, started their 2025 media blitz with those admittedly adorable woolly mice that they made as a proof of concept on their road to making a mammoth. I'll save the dire SciComm situation they created for someone else in this series to recap over the next few days. In the meantime, take a listen to the Dinosaur Choir, a new hadrosaur-inspired instrument created by musicians Courtney Brown and Cesare Gajewski that debuted and won third place at the 27th Guthman Musical Instrument Competition. Musical auditoriums weren't the only civil halls seeing some fossil-related action. In mid-March, a lawsuit was filed against New Jersey's William Paterson University by one of their environmental science professors, Martin Becker. In June of 2024, Becker, a paleontologist by practice, had sent about 200 Devonian fossils from his collection to a colleague in Florida with the intent of working on a collaborative project. After getting reports that the package had never arrived at its destination and 3 months of no useful updates, he finally learned in mid-September that UPS had canceled the university's account back in April because they'd failed to pay several outstanding invoices. The UPS fraud department had then intercepted the packages and dumped all 19 boxes into an unidentified landfill somewhere in or around Nashville, Tennessee. The details of Becker's lawsuit remain unspecified, but several news outlets reported that he was seeking, among other things, medical expenses for the emotional distress the ordeal caused him. So, if you ever find yourself in or around Nashville and want a really memorable fossil hunting story, there you go. On the topic of saving pieces of natural heritage, an academic report published by Maximilian Felix Chami and colleagues from Tanzania and Germany discussed the current state of efforts to preserve the Tendaguru paleontological site. As I mentioned in my last Paleo Rewind video back in 2021, the late Jurassic Tendaguru Formation in northwestern Tanzania hosted the largest fossil dig in history, with hundreds of local Africans working under early 20th century German colonial rule to locate, excavate, and transport over 225 tons of fossils in just a four-year period, fossils that have ultimately ended up as a museum centerpiece far from their place of origin, like the famous giraffe Titan in Berlin. This paper provides an overview of the scientific, economic, and management challenges left behind in the wake of the colonial-era fossil rush, from the lack of proper description and preservation of the Tendaguru site to the local economic and cultural desire to have their dinosaurs returned home. There's a lot in this paper, and it's well worth a read for anyone interested in the human side of paleontology from an often overlooked perspective. Continuing on this thread of the effects of scientific colonialism, another study led by Ana Valenzuela Toro looked at the biases on research and citation patterns in Latin American paleontology. They specifically looked at the last 30 years of publication trends on fossil aquatic mammals, a well-represented category in the continent's rock layers. The results are generally unsurprising. Authorship teams tend to be led by researchers from the global north and skew heavily male, even when the fossils themselves have not been removed from the region of origin, and in some Latin American countries, the majority of paleontologists specializing in these creatures are women. These patterns then go on to be reinforced by who gets cited in subsequent studies, creating a cycle of underrepresentation and continual inequity, even while the gender gap in Latin American paleontology has been steadily decreasing. Proposed strategies to address these issues should sound fairly familiar to anyone involved in genuine DEI work. For example, scientists at institutions in more privileged positions need to cultivate and maintain symmetrical relationships with their Global South collaborators. Journals need to acknowledge the institutional barriers to publication, like writing in a second or third language, and accommodate accordingly. And scientific institutions and societies should not shy away from meaningful representation of the diversity of people in their fields. This applies to science in general, but particularly in such a globe-spanning subject like paleontology. Just look at everywhere we've been in the last 15-ish minutes. For our final entry, we have a study led by Corentin Laron on the identity of Prototaxites, the Earth's first large terrestrial life forms. These strange 8-meter-tall organisms towered over the early Devonian landscapes some 400 million years ago, and have long been considered a giant fungus. However, this new study, admittedly still a preprint at this point, looked at a combination of cellular and molecular information and compared that to modern and extinct fungi. The results suggest something particularly interesting, that Prototaxites belongs to a new, entirely different, completely extinct lineage of multicellular eukaryotes. Just sit with that for a second. Imagine discovering a whole other kingdom of life from the deep past. If that's not a mic drop moment, I don't know what is. And that's a wrap for my March wrap-up. Like I said before, there's a bunch of other stories I didn't include in this video for the sake of time, and I didn't get into as much depth as I could have on any of the ones I did cover, but you can check the description for my full list and read them all for yourself. If there's anything else that happened this month that I missed, feel free to let me know in the comments, or tell me what your favorite piece of paleo news was. Stay tuned for a review of April by George the Dino Guy, and thanks again to Edge for having me join Paleo Rewind 2025. It's been nice to flex the video-making muscles again. Perfect timing, too. 2026 is going to be an exciting year for me, and I hope you lovely viewers will stick around to see why. Until then, many thanks, stay safe, and I will see y'all next year.